I feel it's very weird. This is almost uncomfortable with the cameras. You were used to it, but
no, actually, I haven't done an interview in almost 6 months. I mean, really? Many months. Yeah.
Really?
Yeah.
Have you done it on Zoom?
No.
No. Okay. Was it nice to have a break?
Deliberately not done interviews.
Mm. Okay. Well, so we're extra honored now that you're with us.
Yeah. I know, Kevin, that you were just saying that people like me consume far too much, but both of you do take quite significant steps to consume differently than a lot of other people. Like, both of you don't fly or haven't flown for many, many years. Actually, the last time I flew in Europe was 5 years ago or so, 7 years ago, the day after I had met Kevin for the first time. And you'd had a talk, and then I was talking to you. We were met later in the evening, and then I said I had to leave to pack to go to Iceland. And then Kevin's like, oh, I went to Iceland. Yeah, I was on a boat for 4 very stormy days where you had to, like, hold on to the to your seat to not slip off. I was like, okay, well, I'm going to go pack to take a flight tomorrow. And I think it made a big impact on me, so I haven't flown in Europe since then.
Okay, great.
Yeah. So you both do that, and I think that's one of the reasons that also for you, Kevin, there's not a lot of climate scientists who do that. There's more and more people who stop flying, but I mean, I think that you were one of the first climate scientists to do that. So what do you think about that? What is the role of individual action? And obviously it is powerful, but is there a danger in putting too much on the individual and instead of focusing on systemic issues?
I think when we talk about individual action, people seem to only think about using less plastic and so on. But using individual action, at least for me, is becoming an activist and advocate for these things in every part of your life. And being an activist can be everything from stop flying, because it's, as you said, Kevin, had an impact on you. That is also one way of being an activist, at least I think so. For example, I did not stop flying in order to reduce my carbon footprint. At least, of course, that was some part of it, but mostly I did it to influence the people around me. And especially when I gained a platform, that was a way of signaling that we are in an emergency. And in an emergency, you change your behavior. Of course, I realized that I am very privileged in order to even have the opportunity of taking flights. Mm-hmm. But I believe that making that effort sends a signal to others that we are in an emergency. And that is one way of being an activist. Because, and of course, we should not only be focusing on individual action, we should rather be focused on a more systemic change that we need to achieve. But of course, we can't have systemic change without also individuals realizing the emergency and taking action. It does not have to become vegan or such, even though that is, of course, good, because it influences the people around you. But much more it's about going out on the streets and making your voices heard.
I don't see individual action and system change as different things. They're the same things. It's the same coin. You just flip it over. And I think it happens in the academic realm, a lot of academics use this language, oh, it's all about individual change. We need to be changing the system. I think that it's often deliberately misused to protect what it is that they're actually doing.
You said that they say it's individual action doesn't really matter that
doesn't
much.
Really it's matter. Systemic. Yeah, mm-hmm. I think a lot of people say that. Mm-hmm. Academic colleagues I have say that, and they are doing it sometimes deliberately, sometimes with a certain sense of understanding that they are trying to protect what it is that they do in their lives, in our lives. Mm-hmm. I think if we just did individual action, and I often get asked about this in presentations, what do you think we can do? And I would sort of say, well, think about what your sort of largest carbon element part of your life is. Where's your most emissions of your carbon comes from? And try and change it. So, but I don't really care about whether you're successful or not. What I care about is you talk about that with your friends, with your colleagues, when you're down the pub, with your family, with your work colleagues, that you might engage with your local policymakers about this. So the point about it is, and we have an absolute history of research showing this, that when you make the changes yourself, people take more notice of your arguments, this sort of credibility. So it doesn't change how valid our arguments are, but the credibility of those arguments changes significantly. And there's just repeated work on this. And so if we want to make our arguments about system change stick or have more credibility, then what we know from the research is change how we live our lives. Put the two, make sure they're in some way aligned. No, they're not going to be perfect. We're all hypocrites in one way or another. But at least make some reasonable attempt to align those two positions. And if you do that, people take a lot more notice of the things you are saying about the system change. So when people say it's not about individual change, I think that really often deliberately misunderstands this, how system change comes about. It comes about through those two things being allied together because they're both the same coin. They're just two sides of that same coin.
And both of you come into contact with quite a lot of famous people.
Greta, many more than me, I think.
Perhaps Greta more than you, or have done at least. I don't know how it is now. And I think that, you know, some famous people become very engaged for climate issues. And by some, that's seen as a very good thing, that you know, celebrities are taking their responsibility as citizens. And for others, they see it as like, well, you know, they're just flying around the world to make a documentary about how climate change is bad or something like that, and call them the climate glitterati is a phrase I've heard in that context. So what are your guys' thoughts on that? Do you have any thoughts?
I mean, of course, it's good if someone who has a lot of reach talk to their followers or fans about the climate because it might bring more people along. But as you say, the credibility is maybe not that good if they at the same time fly private jets. It kind of sends a signal that you can care about the climate and still live that extreme, absurd lifestyle. Because celebrities are people that we look up to. Inevitably, many people want to be like them. We aspire to live like them. Their lifestyle is seen as success. So, of course, people are going to try to take on their behavior. And I think that could be a bit dangerous. If everyone's dream is to have 5 houses, a private jet, and 10 cars, of course, it's not about individual action only, but that is completely contradictory to what they are saying. If, for example, there's a film star who flies private jet, let's not mention any names, but if there is such a person and who still talk about we need to save the planet, at least for me, that doesn't really seem like it's an emergency. It's like, okay, so it's if they are doing that, then it's not as important as they are saying. And that doesn't send a message that we are in a crisis.
I've probably almost all of my life, I've never warmed to the idea of celebrity.
Yeah.
I often, because it seems that they're somehow they're great people, they're held up in almost everything they speak about. We want to hear every word that they utter on every subject. Yeah. And I was to say that I've never met a great person, or I've only met great people, one or the other.
Yeah.
And so when these stars and the celebrities speak about these things, as Greta points out, they do have a lot of, they can have a lot of influence. But unless I think that they are demonstrating that influence in how they are trying to live their lives, then I think it's empty. And in fact, I think it's almost worse than doing nothing. Because I think they give the impression you can solve these things with a bit of shiny tech. Mm. And so, I mean, I hear this repeatedly. And it can be the Musks. I will name a few names. It can be the Musks and the Gates of this world, or the Schwarzeneggers of this world, who will talk about it's perfectly okay to have your 600 horsepower Humvee as long as it's electrically powered. You know, no, that's not all right. If we try to get 9 to 10 billion people by 2050 living like that, it will be an utter disaster on the way there. So we have to remove that view that somehow that's a possible world. It's an impossible world. And so if these people could actually carry on doing whatever they happen to be doing, you know, they're great singers or whatever they are, actors, but actually start to say, well, I'm going to try to align my consumption, my lifestyle broadly with the sort of things I'm saying, then I think that would be a phenomenally strong message. Yeah. And if they were starting to do that, you know, I would really welcome that. But when they do it with another bit of shiny kit and somehow think that absolves them of the responsibility and that provides a positive message, I think that completely misunderstands the scale of the challenges we face. As Greta says, that's not how you respond to an emergency, by getting some sustainable aviation fuel for your private jet and making sure you've got a heat pump in one of your, you know, one of your spare houses.
Yeah. I mean, for some reason, the billionaires of today who speak up on the climate are seen as heroes. When in fact, I mean, they are the villains. They are the biggest villains when it comes to the climate emergency, the ones who have caused the absolute most harm among those who have caused the absolute worst harm. And I think we need to hold them accountable. And we cannot hold them up as heroes. Yeah.
Let's not just make this just about the billionaires. I mean, there were lots of people who aren't that wealthy, yeah. But so, you know, there are lots of senior people in universities earning huge amounts of money. The average income in the UK is around about £30,000. A professor's probably on £70,000. Some of the professors will be on 100, 150. Our vice chancellor probably gets £250,000. So, you know, there's another swathe in our society who aren't the real celebrities, if you like, but we've also lived very profligate lives. But I think the problem with some of these, particularly some of these sort of billionaires and that sort of class cadre of people, is that they set a lot of the political and social norms of our society as well. They're particularly the economic norms. You know, with other colleagues that I've worked on this, you know, we've referred to them as this, you know, the Davos Set. They set the norms within which then society has to operate, and that percolates right the way down to what should we fund for universities, for instance. So what research should we fund on climate change? Well, we'll fund this research on some new shiny bits of kit. We won't fund the research on how do you get radical social change. And so right the way through the system, that particular group not only have massive carbon footprints, but they have created a structure that is embedded or we completely reliant on this extractive industries and the way that we do it, as we spoke about before. And I think with that we have to break. It's not just their actual resources. It's the fact is that they set these political social norms that unfortunately percolate right the way down through our society. And I think we have a real responsibility to unpick that. And I don't think the power just resides in them. We let them have the power. This comes back to, again, Greta's point earlier, that these movements can emerge and change things. And we don't wait, we shouldn't be waiting for them to hand the power down to other people. We should be just taking it off them. Yeah. And changing the system.
I think that a lot of people feel like when they're faced with this information and then, you know, you start thinking of, well, maybe we can solve it with new technology. And then you start realizing about, well, all the materials that go into making an electric car, for example. And then you think, well, maybe we can just regulate it out of existence. And then you start to understand that, well, there are so many dimensions to this problem, and there's so many ways that we could try to treat it that would make other things worse or that are only part of the same extractivist logic that we've been thinking about. And so when you talk about these issues and when you talk about this change that needs to happen, do you feel that you are speaking with a certain vision in mind of what a better world would look like, certain things that would be part of that other kind of system that we need to engage for, or are you more just wanting to make it clear that we can't go on as we have been?
Both. I mean, it's a very big question, and of course there is no simple answer to this is how we solve the climate emergency. For to begin with, we have to acknowledge that we have already caused irreparable damage. We have lost things that we can no longer save. We will lose things that we will not be able to save. So it's and that just underlines the issue of time, the aspect of time when it comes to the climate emergency. Of course, we don't have time to design a perfect society, but at least we have to we have to start with what we have. We have to find the solutions along the way. Yeah.
I have a vision, if you like,
mm-hmm.
but it's like a lot of people's visions. It's not wonderfully formed. It's a bit of a messy thing. It's like slightly sort of looking at it through a sort of Vaseline lens. You can't quite see all the detail.
Mm.
But I also think that's my vision as a citizen. And it has no more validity than someone else's vision. You know, as someone who works intimately and for a long time on climate change, I have a lot more knowledge and understanding of those issues. And what I have to be quite careful about, and I think we all have to be careful about this, is not to muddle those two up. So I'm happy to be quite honest about my politics. I'm probably quite left-leaning in many respects. Bizarrely, left-leaning with quite a strong libertarian streak to that as well. But I do lean quite a long way left. So fairness is an absolutely key view, key part of my vision. Now, fairness is a bit of a nebulous term. It can be interpreted slightly differently, but most of us have a broad sense of what fairness is, and we probably share a lot of interpretations of what it looks like. So fairness is an absolutely key part, but also freedom in that. But that freedom, it's a freedom from and a freedom to argument here. You know, I think we should be free to do what we want, provided we don't infringe on other people's freedoms. And so, although I'm quite left-leaning, that's a strong libertarian streak. But of course, that has the constraints on the freedom too are huge. When we do what we do at the moment, for those people like myself, the wealthy ones in the world, we are constraining other people's freedoms to live good lives elsewhere. So we shouldn't be allowed to do those. And so there's those combination of things that I want to, you know, that to me sort of set the sort of framework within which a good world would be. But the actual makeup of that world, the last thing I want is for it to be exactly as I would like it to be. Because what I love about the world is it is eclectic, it's messy, there are things I don't like in it. And that's a good thing. You know, as long as those things I don't like aren't actually innately bad, and a lot of things we do are bad, I don't want the bad things there. But I'm happy for the people to live individualistic, tech-type lives if they want to, that I wouldn't want to live, provided it doesn't infringe on freedoms, on the freedoms of people to live good lives elsewhere. So it's that combination that I see as, you know, with fairness at its core. And what I would like to say in this, although my politics lean in a particular direction, I think what we have to be really careful about is that this is not responding to climate change and sustainability, and even issues of fairness, is not something that is the privilege of the left, where I spend most of my time residing. So I don't want us to polarise responding to climate change on a left-right sort of divide, because I don't think it should be like that. And unfortunately, I think it has happened like that. And I think the right have been deliberately pushing it in that direction, and the left have been happy for it to go in that direction. But I think that's a real mistake. This is an issue for all of us, regardless of which direction our politics swings. Let's respond to climate change and the broader sustainability goals. And let's argue for our different politics within that remit.
I've definitely personally experienced sort of periods of despair, almost like sort of semi-depression because of, well, the climate issue specifically, but also more broadly, just how much destruction we've sort of wrought on the earth, both its human and non-human parts. And if I understand correctly, Greta, you have also had periods in your life where this has been a very tough thing. And I don't know how that is for you, Kevin, if you've also experienced that, but I wanted to ask you both if you've, what ways you've found of sort of dealing with that or responding to it.
I mean, yeah, definitely. Many, many people, including me, have had periods in their lives in which they have like experienced depression and so on for different reasons. For mine, it was partly because of the way that of everything that was happening in the world and so on. And of course, I am privileged enough to be able to witness it from afar. But still, it was something that got to me and that affected me in that way. I think that the best, if not the only sort of medication for that is to do something yourself about it, to step up and act towards something you want or against something that you dislike. And that has given at least me a purpose. And I feel like many today live our lives without any purpose whatsoever. So that is something that has definitely made me happy in that way, because I feel like I'm doing something that is meaningful. I have a purpose.
I've never suffered from depression, but I have seen a lot of people around me suffer from it. Quite a lot of those people have worked on climate change, and that has not helped them, I think it's fair to say. So I can try and understand that. I think I do understand it. I can't empathize with it because I can't be that person. I don't know what that feels like, but I can see the results of that in them.
Well, what do you do when you're down?
I think for me, it's always been relatively straightforward. Maybe I'm just a simpler soul like this. I don't know, but most of my friends are relatively sort of working classes, how we'd use in the UK, people who didn't go to university. Some of them did, but a lot of them didn't. And I think there's a really refreshing openness in dialogues with them that helps me just remember that, you know, life's a wonderful thing to live in, to live through, and for those of us in the fortunate positions. And so I go out cycling with them or rock climbing with them, and we don't really talk about climate change. It does come up sometimes when we're doing these things, but other times it's just the usual sort of fun banter of life. And to me, that's really rich. That's what I want us to... I don't want us to have to worry about climate change so we can have more fun banter of life. And it's those things. And being with them and doing those normal things with them, they're not particularly special things. That reminds me how wonderful life can be, and everything's worth fighting for. It doesn't make me depressed. It would probably make me depressed if I knew there's no hope of us overcoming these challenges, but there is hope.
So one thing we talked about is how we're in a climate emergency, but we're not really seeing that kind of response that is in proportion to the challenge that we're facing. And so you can have towns or precincts or countries or companies declaring climate emergency, but then not actually maybe doing anything to sort of back that up. What are you guys thinking about that kind of dynamic?
I mean, when they declare a climate emergency, that's only a symbolic action. They don't actually mean that it is a climate emergency. And as long as no one else is treating it like an emergency, of course, they will not do that either. Because why would they? Why would we change our behavior if there's no climate emergency? Because we are behaving right now as if there was no climate emergency. We are much more focused on other things. The climate emergency is pretty much non-existent in the debate.
Would it then be better to not declare an emergency?
I mean, doing that is, of course, a necessary step towards awareness, towards a full crisis mode. But I think it's a bit hypocritical to talk about the climate emergency in that way when you are not doing anything whatsoever to tackle it.
I'm quite pleased that we're using the language, partly because I think then we can hold people to account that they're using it. And I've tried to do this at a number of events, particularly when I've engaged with policymakers, when they say we have a climate emergency, and then I quickly take some photographs of some slides of big cars outside. Or other high carbon activities, and say, well, hang on, I saw this outside here. These can't really be aligned with emergency, and yet you're the policymakers and say it's okay to carry on like this. So, you know, if you mean it's an emergency, then let's see those emergency measures. And I don't mean let's see them tomorrow. I mean, if it's an emergency, let's see them today. So what are you going to do differently? By using that language, the rest of us, that gives us a really powerful lever if we want to use it to say, well, hang on, you claimed it was a climate emergency. I want to see those emergency powers put in place. I don't want to see you put in place something like, we'll have some electric vehicles in 2030. We'll phase out kerosene planes by 2050. That's not an emergency measure. Tell me your emergency measure for this afternoon and for next week and for the week after that. You can also say to the policymakers, if you're not prepared to act as if it's an emergency, then say, come out and publicly say it. I was wrong. It's not a climate emergency. We're not going to treat it like that. But don't claim it is and then think you can just sit back and do nothing about it. So I'm pleased the language is being used, but I'm also aware that people do bring up the other issues about it can allow unscrupulous policymakers to put in place other things that they want to drive, you know, often to constrain other freedoms. And we've seen that in various parts of the certainly across the democratic world, where hard-fought freedoms of democracy have been then curtailed under sort of the guise of something else like an emergency. And I think we have to be wary of that as well, so to make sure it's not misused.
One of the criticisms against that is that it's such a long-term emergency, so basically it would be like declaring an emergency forever, and emergency powers in such a long-term view would undermine the parliamentary and democratic processes.
Well, no, I think it should open them up.
Hmm.
Because, firstly, you say it's an emergency for a long time. The people who will die tomorrow because of the exacerbated weather conditions brought about by us choosing to carry on with our lives as normal over here, that's not a long time. Their emergency is tomorrow. Their emergency is today. Now, what do we mean by those powers?
Mm.
I don't mean those powers should be put in place to take away democracy. Those powers can be there to enrich democracy by, for instance, enrich democracy by saying, how about those people that have been impacted by the climate emergency today feeding to our policy agenda? So when we have democracy, how come, well, let's get their vote into our decision-making. Not just our votes, but the people who we are actively and often deliberately impacting. So I think it could also, emergency powers could open up democracy. Now, we may choose, and policymakers choose, to close it down, but that's a choice. I actually think genuinely responding to this emergency is one of opening up the debate and making it much more amenable to all of us to get engaged, not one to close it down. So that's why I'm less afraid of the language of emergency, provided the rest of us are quite wary how it will be deliberately misused by unscrupulous policymakers. But not all policymakers are unscrupulous. There are lots of very good policymakers out there who want to make a positive change. So let's engage with them about the climate emergency.
It kind of leads on to the next question, which is, it's maybe a double one, and you can choose what to focus on, which is, what's pissing you off the most right now in this context? But maybe also, where do you see the most threads of change emerging?
The expert community on reducing our emissions. So not the climate science, but often the climate scientists, the expert community is not prepared to be honest to the public, and even sometimes even honest to ourselves. So that really annoys me, that the one job that we really have, which is, or two jobs, do our work carefully and communicate it honestly. We're doing our work carefully, but we're not communicating it honestly. That part really, really annoys me. And so you can probably tell by my demeanor and my tone now. It really, that does piss me off, I think, to use your expression. And where does hope come from? And I find that really interesting, because if you'd asked me that 5 years ago, I'd have really struggled to know where the hope was coming from. It's out there somewhere, but I don't know what it looks like. And actually, things have changed significantly. And, you know, I don't like sycophancy and all that sort of thing, but Greta's been key to that. You know, as a catalyst, I mean, Greta isn't going to save the world. None of us are. But we can catalyze change. And Greta has built on the other things that have made who she is. And she has then gone out and made as much noise, thoughtful noise as she can. And that's helped other people step up and make their noise and engage in these debates. And so actually hope hasn't come from the great and good. It hasn't come from the professors. It hasn't come from the policymakers. The hope that I really see is there now has emerged much more bottom up. And it's not just the Greta's of this world, or the Extinction Rebellions of this world, or the Insulate UK back in the UK, one of the new sort of NGOs, if you like, or the formal NGOs. It's actually that dialogue that these people have brought to the fore, to the news, to the journalists and so forth, is now happening everywhere, on trains and on buses. People are talking about these issues. And people might often say, well, they don't really understand the carbon budgets or what these CO2 molecules are like compared to methane. I don't care. They're engaging these issues. They're thinking about these things. They're trying things out. And I love that idea that there's this sort of gradually increasing sort of global experiment, if you like, on how we should try and do things differently. And that, out of that, I think, is where we get the hope. So I think the last few years, it's come out of civil society movements. The last place I would have ever thought where my hope would have come from if you'd asked me 5 years ago. But to me, that's actually really important. And the one add-on I'd say to that is that how important that is, almost forget your national leaders to a degree. Actually, local policymakers are starting to change their narratives much more in line with what civil society is asking for. They're almost like national governments have always seemed to be behind the local governments. Now, I'm not saying that they're putting the policies in place, but they're certainly putting the target framework, they're using the right language, they're talking much more about the concept of an emergency, about being now, not about 2050. So I think there's that's a real hope as well, that sort of combination of things there.
Yeah. But the people who are well aware of the situation and who actively choose not to communicate it as it is, and who actively hold back on informing others about the emergency that we are facing. Not only scientists, but maybe especially the media, because it is their role, their job, to inform people about these issues. And they have not done that, whether it is because of a lack of information, awareness, knowledge. But I mean, they have access to all of that. So then it could be that just that they are just too afraid of being framed as alarmists. Yeah, that is a real issue, but also a real source of hope, because imagine if they actually would start to change, then they have all the resources, they have the possibility. Just look at, for example, how things changed during the corona pandemic, just look at the war in Ukraine, that media can actually treat a crisis like a crisis. When they focus on issues, they can completely shift the narrative around it in almost no time. As you say, I also think that the hope, the changes are happening from the bottom up. I see the most hope that is happening right now with my fellow activists, with people who are speaking up, who are risking their popularity, risking their status, to be blunt and to be uncomfortable, that I find really hopeful. Yeah, those who dare to speak the truth. Like, for example, you, like many, many people around the world who are now walking the walk.
I think on that, but also there's a small, well, you'll know some of these much better than I will, but there's also a small group of these people who not only risking their credibility, but risking their lives.
Their freedom.
Yeah. And I think, I mean, I just don't know what, I have just huge admiration for those people that are prepared to stand up in regimes that you know that you can go missing, your family can go missing.
Yeah.
I don't think I could ever have that courage to do that. And for those people, I just think that there's almost an extra responsibility on the rest of us to try and lend them as much support as possible.
Yeah, definitely.
Thanks so much for having this conversation. It was really, really valuable.
Thanks very much.